It's Sunday. My name's John, and I am so excited to get to worship with each one of you today. Now look, in-person worship here at Foundation Church, it's begun, but that doesn't mean that we don't love worshiping with each and every one of you online any less. As a matter of fact, I am so excited and so grateful that you're willing to join us this morning. Now, if this is your first time with us, let me give you a heads up on what's going to be happening. In just a moment, a countdown's going to begin, but when that timer hits zero, the service is going to start. You're going to get to experience some incredible music put forth by our worship team, an awesome biblically based relevant message. You're going to have a chance to speak to God, and we're going to be interspersing some cool things for the kids. So get ready, sit tight. The service is going to begin soon. As a matter of fact, it's going to begin in 4 minutes.
Woke up early just to see the sun. With every possibility, you're making all of me undone. Not so sure yet, but I think that I might melt into your body as you sway on the backseat of my bike. For a happy ending.
Good morning, Foundation Church. Welcome to our online service. Listen, this morning we're gonna sing over your life and we're gonna believe that the best is yet to come. So we're gonna invite you to sing wherever you are. It's gonna be a fun morning.
And thanks so much for joining us online for worship this morning. My name's John. I'm the pastor here, and I'm beyond excited to worship with each and every one of you.
Now look, we've got something really cool going on this month at Foundation Church, this month, July. And that is that we are collecting canned goods for people all around the Oxford community. We're trying to collect 400 cans. I think we can do it. Some people have said, hey, that seems like way too many. If you'd love to join us as we make a difference in the lives of families in and around Oxford, then go ahead and collect up some canned goods and bring them here to Foundation Church, 3505 Vestal Parkway East or 36 South Washington Ave, Oxford, New York. With that said, I got something special going on for the kids. Kids, are you ready? At the count of three, that's going to be one, two, three. At the count of three, I want all the kids to run into the kitchen as quick as you can and find a can that your family can donate to our canned goods food drive. Are you ready? One, two, three.
I choose this day to be grateful, Lord. I give you praise with an open heart. I'm waking up to heaven. I'm waking up to you. I'm waking up to heaven.
Thank you.
sing of my soul, and it's my joy to thank you. Oh, thank you, and you alone are waking up my soul, and it's my joy to thank you. Oh, thank you. Darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I own, when brokenness and pain is all I know, oh, I won't be shaken, oh, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your light. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your light. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your light. Well, shame alone, there has a place to hide. I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. Oh, I won't be shaken. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your light. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your light. Doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. Power in your name, oh, power in your name. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Cause my fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in. Fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. I'm standing in your love, stand in your love. I'm standing on. Standing in your
love. I love you, Lord.
hopeful this worship experience has been awesome for you so far. We have this incredible privilege, this incredible opportunity to speak directly to God. Now, as Christians, we call that prayer, but all it is talking to God. And in a moment, you're going to have the opportunity to do that all on your own, to say whatever you want to God. We're going to conclude that time of silent prayer, though, with a prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. It's commonly called the Lord's Prayer. If you don't know that prayer, feel free to open your eyes. We'll put it right up on the screen for you. With that direction given, I'm going to invite you to enter into that time of speaking with God. God, not only do you hear our prayers, but you know them before we speak them. And yeah, God, you ask us to speak to you, to be in relationship with you, to be known and to know you. Lord God Almighty, hear our prayers as now we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. My knees were shaky. My voice was wavering more than a little bit. My thoughts were all over the place. Yeah, this was the first time I ever stood up in front of a group of people as the pastor. I was terrified. And maybe I'm getting a little ahead of myself. My name's John. Today we are beginning a brand new series entitled New Beginnings. This is a series designed to look at new things in our lives and compare those to the process of following Jesus, also known as discipleship. So today we're going to talk about new jobs, starting a new job. And I want to start right there with the question, what is your job? Go ahead and take a second and comment right down below and tell everyone what your job is. Now, kids who are watching, it's completely okay for you to say, my job is having fun, or my job is to learn. Or if you're one of my kids, it's okay for you to say, my job is to do whatever my dad tells me. My kids love it when I say stuff like that. Look, probably all of you know, but in case you didn't know, my job is a pastor. I am a pastor. I started when I was 20, and at the age of 38, so if you're good with math, 18 years later, I'm still a pastor. But that very first Sunday, that first time I walked down the aisle and stood in front of a group of people to deliver a message, a sermon, I was terrified. My knees were shaking. My voice was wavering, and my thoughts were everywhere. Mostly, though, I was thinking, I got to get out of here. They're going to find out I'm a fake, I'm a fraud, I'm not really what they think I am. And so as I was walking down that aisle, as I was coming up to stand behind the pulpit, I had a stack of books like this high, and a stack of Bibles equally high, and then, oh, by the way, a whole bunch of notes. And in my mind, I thought, if I have enough books and enough Bibles and enough notes, maybe they won't realize that I'm faking it. Maybe they won't realize that I'm not really a pastor and I'm just trying to figure it out. Maybe they won't realize I'm a fraud. You see, what I was experiencing is an incredibly common phenomenon, sometimes called imposter syndrome. It often afflicts people when they achieve a promotion at work or when they start a new job. It's where they are by title one thing, but in their minds, something different. This has afflicted such famous and successful people as Maya Angelou, Neil Armstrong, Tom Hanks, and Michelle Obama. Each one of them has said publicly that they experienced some form or some degree of imposter syndrome. And I want to suggest to you today that this doesn't only affect us at work. this is a reality in our spiritual lives as well. And so today, as we talk about the beginning of this journey to follow Jesus, the beginning of being a disciple, and we talk about what that looks like and how to navigate that, as we talk about that today, I want to give you some good news. Hopefully, an invitation and a reminder that if you experience this imposter syndrome, if you feel like you're not quite there yet, that's okay. To help us have this conversation today, we're going to use a scripture reading from the book of Ephesians. I'm going to be reading Ephesians chapter 2, verses 10 to 13. Now, you can go ahead and follow along in your Bibles, or we'll put the words on the screen. You can follow along that way as well. But let me quickly tell you that Ephesians was a letter written to a group of new Christians, a church filled with people who were once called Gentiles. That means they weren't raised Jewish, so they have literally no background for their newfound Christian faith. And they're being encouraged by the Apostle Paul, who likely helped start their church. So Ephesians chapter 2, verses 10 to 13. For we are called God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Therefore, remember that formerly you who were Gentiles by birth and called uncircumcised by those who call themselves the circumcision, which is done in the body by human hands. Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenants of the promise, without hope and without God in the world. By now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. This is God's word. It's given freely to each and every one of you. And I want to take you all the way back to verse 10. This is Ephesians chapter 2, verse 10, which reads again, "For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." There's two words that I want to highlight there, or two parts that I want to highlight. The first one is that word handiwork. Now, that work can be craftsmanship, it can be handiwork, but the translation that I like the best of that is masterpiece. For we are God's masterpiece. The point here, no matter what word you use to translate that, is that God made us. God created us the way we are. We're furthermore told that God created us in Jesus to do good things. The last part of this verse I also want to highlight. Now, some of you perhaps have had a job or done a job where you've said something like, "I was made for this. I love this." The author of Ephesians says it differently. See, he says, "which God prepared in advance for us to do." What God is preparing is not us in this instance. It is the work. The point here is that God has made you as his masterpiece. But then God created good works, jobs, just for you. So this job was created for you as opposed to you created for the job. I love thinking of it that way. Now I want to keep pushing forward. I want to go to Ephesians chapter 2, verse 12. There the author continues by saying, "Remember that at that time," that time there, by the way, is before you were a Christian, before you followed Jesus. "Remember that at that time you were separate from Christ, excluded from citizenship in Israel and foreigners to the covenant of the promise, without hope and without God in the world." There's a few words that I want to highlight there. Separate, excluded, foreigners. Now, I think for all of us, there are seasons and times where we feel that way, where we feel separate, excluded, foreigners, like we don't belong. Unfortunately, the world is really good at making us feel that way. I want to suggest that we are all living in a time and a season in this world where more than our fair share of us feel separate, excluded, and like foreigners. And I want to invite you to just name that today. See, if that includes you, if you are feeling separate, excluded, like a foreigner, perhaps even afraid I want you to comment down below and say, me, right? That's me. I feel that way. Because I've got some really, really good news for you. A, you're not alone. But B, as we continue with this passage, Ephesians chapter 2, on into verse 13. See, Ephesians 2, 13 reads, but now in Christ Jesus, you who once were far away have been brought near by the blood of Christ. So perhaps you are feeling separate and excluded, even, dare I say, afraid. But the good news is that now, because of Jesus, you can be brought near. Now, I know there's somebody out there saying, I'm not feeling that. I'm still feeling separate and excluded and like a foreigner and, yeah, a little afraid. There's this really cool thing going on here with this phrase, brought near. That brought near has a sense of action and time going on. And so while that brought near may be an instantaneous moment, there's also some work that's still happening with it. It's similar, going back to our new job analogy, it's similar to when you get hired for a job, you are hired that moment. But there's some time before you can actually do that job, and even more importantly, before you feel like you can do that job. Now, I want to take a minute and I want to invite you to go ahead and think back to your very first job, or think back to your most recent job if your first job was too far away. I'm going to share with you my first job. It wasn't being a pastor. My very first job was as the stock boy for Lawler's grocery store in Owego, New York. Now, Lawler's, if you've never been there, is a tiny little grocery store that sells way more beer, cigarettes, and lottery tickets than anything else in the store. And so my job largely consisted of stocking their very large walk-in beer cooler. Lawler's also was a small business with not a lot of employees and not a lot of turnover in staff. As a matter of fact, after I was hired, the next newest employee had been working at Lawler's for 7 years. He was the new guy until I showed up. At Lawler's, I was trained by the owner's son. This was awesome because he knew everything. This was also very, very difficult because he treated the business like an owner. Everywhere we went, we walked fast. I mean, really, really fast. Sometimes I had to run to keep up with him so that I could hear what he was saying and learn how to do the job right. But for weeks, literally weeks of 8-hour shifts, I followed the owner's son around the store and tried to pick up everything he said. I walked right behind him. As a matter of fact, after a while, I began to walk like him. I was trying to do everything I could to be like him so I could do the job the way I was supposed to do the job. Perhaps you've had that experience as well. When you start a new job, it can be overwhelming. And whoever's training you, if you're lucky enough to get training, let's be honest, whoever's training you, you're trying your hardest just to pick up everything that you can so you can be successful, so you can be effective in the job. Following Jesus, being a disciple, it's a lot like starting a new job. There may be an instantaneous moment where we begin the journey, but that doesn't always mean that we feel it instantaneously. And so the goal there is to follow as closely to Jesus as we can so that we can become as much like him as possible. Now, you probably already know this because I know I'm talking to a lot of really smart people, but this notion of discipleship, it's not exclusive to Christianity. As a matter of fact, discipleship is a notion that has roots in Judaism, right? In the Jewish faith. And so rabbis or teachers of Jewish people, they would gather disciples around them and their disciples would follow them around, walking like them, talking like them, doing what they did, trying to be like them. Later, Christians came along and took that idea and said, we are trying to follow the greatest or best rabbi or teacher, God's son, Jesus. But there was this really cool saying that Jews had at that time about discipleship. And the saying was, may you be covered in the dust of your rabbi. The idea here is that you're going to follow so closely to your rabbi that he is going to kick up dust and it's going to cover you. The notion also is that you are following your rabbi and doing what he does. As Christians, that's what we're striving to do. We want to follow Jesus so closely that we're going to walk like him and talk like him. But look, I'm getting ahead of myself again. Step number one for today, the first and most important thing you need to understand is to simply claim that identity as a disciple of Jesus. Claim the name Christian. Let me say that again. Claim the name Christian. Now, I've been doing this for a long time, this being a pastor. But 18 years ago, I had to have that first day that I walked up in front of people and claimed the name pastor. It was scary and intimidating. And I realized that for some of you, today, claiming the name Christian, striving to be a disciple of Jesus, that's scary and that's intimidating. But today you can begin that journey. Perhaps others of you have already been walking on this path. You've already claimed the name, but you're still not quite feeling it. Or maybe you've even stopped or taken a break. Today, you can reclaim the name Christian. Others, yeah, perhaps today you can be reminded that you are God's masterpiece, that you are God's handiwork, that God made you and said, you are very good. Regardless of where you are on this journey, I want to remind you that while we were all once far away, we have all been brought near. Friends, I'm going to invite you to join me in prayer. God, we give you thanks for this journey called discipleship that we are invited into. Remind us of this invitation that it's open to all. Lord, also remind us of your grace and your love and your desire to draw us near. God, in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So our service is almost over. In just a moment, the worship team is going to bring you one last song. But while that's happening, I want to give each and every one of you an opportunity to come alongside us here at Foundation Church as we strive to make a difference in this world. One of the ways that we invite you to do that is through the giving of your tithes, your gifts, and your offerings. And we'll even put a helpful link right down below in the comments for you to give online if you'd like. Now look, if this is your first, your second, or your third time worshiping with us, we don't want you to give any kind of gift. We would just love it if you would comment down below and let us know that you're with us for the first, the second, or the third time. With that said, I'm going to invite you to follow the leadership of our worship team.
So good. With every breath that I
So as our service today comes to a close, as things begin to wind down, I want to let you know what's going to be happening next week, because we want you to come on back and join us next week. Next week, we're going to continue this series, New Beginnings, and the message is going to be entitled New Car. Now, we're going to be talking about getting a new car, what your first car was, but we're also going to be talking about modifying our behaviors, our patterns, our habits, those things that discipleship really makes a lasting impact on. So come on back and join us next week. But with that said, receive these words, a blessing and benediction today. May you go forth with the God who loves you, with the one who took you from being a stranger and made you a family member. Go with Christ and go in his peace. Amen.
Hey, I know you hung out to the very end to find out who the unsung heroes are this week. So without further ado, let me tell you who they are. This week, we had two awesome people show up to mow and trim the churchyard. Now, you may or may not have noticed, but we are in the process of changing over our lawn care, and it turns out July, that's not the time to try to do that. So a huge shout out goes to Liz and Tim Bunsey. Tim and Liz came, they worked hard, and they made our lawn look amazing. Big round of applause to you two. You're both rock stars. Friends, thanks so much for joining us, and have an awesome day.